And thank you for inviting me, because I would probably miss this lecture. Thank you.
Wait a moment. We're good to go? Okay. Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
It's very nice to be here. My name is Ella Myer. I am an American, but I've been working for the last 4 years in Lithuania at a place called LCC International University in Klaipėda, Lithuania. And I'm here to talk with you about multiculturalism. I'd like us to think together about the benefits and the challenges of multiculturalism. I first want to thank, however, ICU-Kyiv and America House for welcoming me to come and spend this evening with you. I am especially interested in cultures and how they interact with each other. This is what we mean when we say multiculturalism. Multiculturalism is when people from different cultures live and work in the same societies, in the same cultures. I have a master's degree in intercultural studies, and at LCC, I am working with these beautiful students that you see right here. At our university in Lithuania, we have students coming from 30 different countries, all living and studying in the same place. And my work is to help bring together these different nationalities, to work through our differences, to learn from each other's cultures, also to get to know our own cultural identity more. And that's what I'm doing there. If we have anybody in the room who are high school students, is there anyone here who's a high school student? High school? Okay, great. So I'm especially glad to see you here, because if through my lecture you become interested in this university, then you can approach me at the end to talk more about the university itself, or talk with my colleague Lydia, who's here in the front. She'd also be happy to answer questions about our university and to give out these pamphlets about the university. But the lecture is not about LCC. The lecture is about multiculturalism and what are the benefits and what are the challenges of this. I'd like to start out with, why is this a relevant topic? Our world today really is smaller and more interconnected than ever before. Somewhat like this image here. Take a moment and think for yourselves, maybe even shout out an answer. Why would I say that our world today is smaller than ever before?
Because we have the internet.
Yeah, absolutely. Internet is huge with this. Any other ways that our world is smaller than before? Yes, you in the back.
There are more people than ever in history that were living on Earth.
Okay, more people than ever. That's true.
Okay, we also can speak about business globalization, because we have multinational corporations mm-hmm. inside our country and abroad where our people are working, and it helps to interact mm-hmm. with each other, with different cultures, mm-hmm. Nations, and so on.
Absolutely. Well, it seems like many of the people who came to this lecture are already thinking about these things. This is really good, so I won't have to convince you too much about the importance of thinking of multiculturalism. I'll give you a few of my examples. So we can say the world is smaller than ever before if you think about global travel and the speed and the efficiency of it. This is a Google Maps showing where I'm coming from in the United States. That's where my family lives. And then to get to my home in Lithuania, where I've been living for 4 years, it takes less than 20 hours. That is remarkably fast, and it means that you have the opportunities to also go really most places in the world very quickly and interact with people that have background quite different from the one that you grew up with. Let's also think about the products we consume. When we talk about interconnectedness, one of my favorite examples is to think about smartphones. Probably many of you have a smartphone. It connects us with the world through the internet and things like that. But I want us to think actually about what makes up this smartphone and where did it come from. My smartphone, at least, was designed in the United States. It's Apple. But inside of the phone, there is metal, there is minerals that make it to work as a smartphone. And these things most commonly come from mines in African countries. Then all of those materials were sent to Southeast Asia, where somebody assembled them into the phone. Then it was put on a plane and sent to Lithuania, where I got it. Many, many things that we use today, probably like on your bodies right now, have those sorts of connections to many different parts around the world. Of course, how many people are wearing clothes, for instance, that were not made in Ukraine? Probably everyone. I'm not going to make you raise your hand because probably everyone is. With the example that the gentleman in the front gave, let's think about the companies that we work for. We probably recognize many of these different brands. But these are international companies. They're not just a company that has a headquarters in one country and sells its products around the world. No, each of these companies has offices in many different places and has employees from different backgrounds that are working together. Let's think about the media that we consume. I'm sure that most of us in the room are consuming media that came from Hollywood. How about anyone who's watching Bollywood movies? Anyone? You really should. You are? Yes, they're quite entertaining. I recommend them if you haven't seen them. Or things like anime. Really, our media doesn't just come from the places that we're from, but we're exposed to cultures and stories from many different places. A few more examples. Today we have about 244 million people who are living outside of the countries that they were born in. So I would be one of those 244 million. That's 3.3% of the world population. And some countries actually have really high percentages of immigrants. Does anyone know which countries in our world today have the highest percentage of foreigners living there? Not people who are ethnically different, but people who moved there from another country. New Zealand?
United States.
United States. Any other guesses? Germany?
Ukraine.
Ukraine? Really? No, the answer is actually countries like the United Arab Emirates and these places in the Middle East have a large percentage of immigrant workers that are coming from poorer countries into these really rich Arab countries there. Some of them have immigrant populations of about 40%. Can you believe that? 40%. That's extremely high. Okay, and then let's also just think about how common it is, how it's becoming increasingly more common to have neighbors who are different religion or culture than you. And I think that all of these examples that I just gave you are not going to be reversed anytime soon. There's no going back to a world where people from different ethnic groups or religions are isolated in their own region and interacting only a little bit through trade with other groups. No, globalization and multiculturalism are here to stay. And everybody in this room needs to have the skills and the nuanced thinking in order to both survive and thrive in this world. And that's what I want us to think about the rest of our time together, is what skills do we need to survive in this world? What kind of nuanced thinking do we need? That's why the title of the lecture is The Benefits and the Challenges, because we should think about both. If you're following the news right now, you'll see that people have some pretty strong opinions about multiculturalism. Just think about Brexit, for instance, and some certain politicians that are coming to power in other places around Europe. There's a pushback against multiculturalism, and there are some people that are saying, no, we need to embrace and develop multiculturalism. It's a good thing. So let's not go into just one or the other camp, but let's think about both the benefits and the challenges. The first thing that all of us need is to start developing actively accurate perceptions of the world around us, not just based on stereotypes or the assumptions that we have. It's extremely easy to walk through life with stereotypes in our minds and assumptions in our minds about what other people are like or think. But let's not fall into that trap. So to do that, we need to work on developing fact-based worldview, you know, based on real statistics or really based on meeting people from these other places. And I have an activity for us to start with, which is going to test your accuracy. How accurate is your perception of the world around you? Our world really is very, very diverse. 6,900 languages, 190 countries, 7.4 billion people. But how accurate and how much do we know about those different people? So we're going to do an activity. Lydia, could you pass these pieces of paper out to people? And for this activity, what you need to do is imagine with me that our world of 7.4 billion people has been made small. We shrunk this world down into a village of just 100 people. So we keep the same proportions, the same ratios as our current world, but we imagine that it's only a village of 100 people. I'm going to show you some different categories, and what I'd like you to do is to get out a pen and make your notes on these pieces of paper. Do we have some extra pens in the room if needed? Yes, so Lydia has some extra pens if you need a pen. If you need a pen, just raise your hand and she will give you one. Make sure you return those pens at the end. I've learned through experience that people walk off with pens. Don't be that person. All right. Anyone still need a pen? Then let's begin. Let's begin with this challenge that I have for you. So if our world was just 100 people, what would it look like? My first series of numbers that I want you to write down is, if our world was 100 people, how many would be Asians, how many Europeans, how many North and South Americans, and how many Africans? So take a minute and a half, and write down your best guesses. Okay, take another 10 seconds to finish up. Okay, so now let's move on to the next category. If our world was a village of 100 people, how many would be men and how many would be women in our village? Now let's think about the conditions, the environment that these people live in. How many would be like you and live in cities? How many would be living in the countryside or rurally? And now the last category, I think, is the most difficult. It asks us to think about religion. Religion is something which shapes the lives of many people around the world. But which religions do people belong to? How many would be Christian, Muslim, Hindu, Buddhist, other religion, or non-religious? Why don't you take another 20 seconds and finish? Okay, let's find out what you thought. For this, I'll just ask you to raise your hand and we can see the general opinions of the people in the room. So if we go back to the first question about which continent people are from, raise your hand based on which one of these categories will have the biggest number, okay? So raise your hand if you think that Asia would have the biggest number. Okay, raise your hand if you think Europe has the biggest number. Okay, how about North and South America? And anybody think Africa has the biggest? Nobody. Okay, so now how about the least? Does anyone think that Asia is going to have the fewest number of people? Okay, Europe? Who thinks Europe has the fewest? Okay, North and South America? And Africa? Who thinks Africa is the smallest? All right. Raise your hand, who thinks that there are more men in the world than women? Okay, who thinks there are more women? All right. Who thinks that more people live in cities? All right. And now for the question about religion, I just used four categories here. Which one of these has the most people? Who thinks that there are more Christians in the world? Muslims? Hindus? And non-religious, don't have a religion. Okay, that's interesting. So I'm going to show you the correct answers. But take a moment and think about, where did you get your information? Stereotypes.
Some ideas from school, from university about some lectures and so on.
You're just trying to reach back in your mind to that geography class that you had. Okay. So here are the correct answers. There would be 61 people in our village from Asia. So you can write down the correct answers if you like next to it. There would be 11 Europeans, 14 North and South Americans, and 14 Africans. I see some people with surprised looks on their faces. Some people are like, no, that's correct. Some others are a little bit more surprised. People tend to be surprised that Asia has just so many people. Most people think that Asians are the majority, but 2 out of 3 people is a lot. Or they tend to be surprised that Europeans are in the minority. You walk around every day, you mostly see Europeans, but that's not the majority of our 7.4 billion people. A last thing that people tend to be surprised about is that there are more Africans than there are Europeans. Let me show you a map which I hope you find as interesting as I do. This is a map of the African continent. Look how really huge Africa is. If we wanted to, we could fit all of Europe, the United States, China, India, Japan, inside of Africa, and you still would have room left. Which makes me wonder, why do we sometimes refer to Africa as though it's a country? Sometimes I hear people saying, we do charity work in India and China and Africa. As though Africa is equivalent to what would be a country. No, it's a very big, diverse continent. And when you meet Africans from the north, for instance, you'll find they're very different from the ones in the south. So I challenge you, next time you hear someone refer to Africa like a country, challenge them. Or the next time that you're saying something about Africa, try to use the name of the country rather than the name of the continent. Okay, good news, everybody. If our world was 100 people, 50-50. 50-50. People tend to be surprised with these numbers, too, because I'm sure that there are more women than there are men in Ukraine. In different parts of the world, one of the genders has more than the others. So in this region, there are more women than men, and there are a variety of reasons for that. Women tend to live longer. Things like alcoholism affect men more than they do women, and it lowers the life expectancy of men. But in other parts of the world, men are more privileged than women are. For instance, in China and in India, it's much higher preference for parents to have boys than to have girls. There's even some really terrible things that some people do, like selective abortions and things like that, which makes some of these countries have really way too many men in comparison to women, which is a problem in society. But overall, it evens out. Okay, so where do people live? 54 in cities and 46 not in cities. Some people made a surprised sound. What were you surprised by?
I'm not surprised, but my idea, for example, was about eco-trend, that nowadays all people, they are addicted to eco-houses, eco-products, mm-hmm. and I decided to put it on my layout, and mm-hmm. that's it.
So you had more people living
rurally.
Yeah. Okay. So perhaps it's a pushback against the trend in our world today towards cities. We actually experienced a transition in the history of humanity in the last 10 years. In 2008 was the time when there was equal numbers of people in cities and not in cities. And since then, it's growing that more and more people are living in cities. And what it means to be human and the human experience is becoming more and more urban. But people probably are pushing back against that because of our attachment to the earth and things like pollution. Okay, and the last one for religion. If it was 100 people, 33 would be Christians, 22 Muslims, 14 Hindus, the majority of which live in India, if you think India has 1 billion people, 7 Buddhists, 12 other religions, and 12 non-religious. So just because Europe, for instance, is trending more towards non-religious does not mean that the world as a whole has stopped including religion in a big portion of their identity and their life. No, it seems that actually, what is that, 88% of the world is still religious in some form. If I had time, I would show you interesting maps about where these religions are. If you were to make a map, you would see almost all of the Hindus living in India and a country or two around there. I don't have time to go into that, but there are some very, very interesting maps. For instance, you could write down, if you're interested in geography, there's a website called World Mapper. And what it does is it uses all sorts of statistics, and it changes what the map of the world looks like. So our map shows the world based on land size, the size of the country, and these maps change it based on the percentage of a certain category who lives there. So for instance, let's think of Jews. Where do the world's Jewish people live? Then Israel would become huge on this map, and so would the United States, and all the other places would almost disappear from the map. So it's an innovative way of looking at the world, and not just about religion, many different things. Okay, so I don't think it will play this way. We're going to show a video in just a second, and the reason I show you this video is that we've just done this activity that challenged you about your view of the world. Hopefully it corrected some misconceptions. But don't let this activity be the only thing you think about when you think of the world as a whole and the different types of people that you share the world with. You should always associate actual faces, people, with stories and families and values and dreams with the numbers that you put down on the paper. You cannot limit your understanding of these parts of the world just with a number. So we're going to show a video which is taken from a documentary called Human, which I also recommend. It explores what does it mean to be human. And there'll be a number of people from all around the world saying hello to you in their languages. And please look into their faces. Try to understand what language they're speaking, but also notice kind of their character, their humor. What's in them that you share with them, or what's in them that maybe is different from you? My goal is for you to remember that those numbers are real people. So can we show the video?
Hello. 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 Hello.
Hello.
Assalamu alaikum.
Ni hao.
Bonjour tout le monde.
Hola a todos, a todos, todos, todos.
A Charlie.
Tashi Dilek.
Namaste.
Здравствуйте.
Guten Tag.
Kalimera.
Hello.
Bonjour.
Yasuminasai.
Paref. Marhaba.
Hola.
Bibarala.
Shalom.
Dobardan. Kakoyekei. Que tal? Buenos días.
Bon dia. Bonjour. Bonne nuit. Bonsoir.
Hey, bonjour.
Salamitsiz bi.
Al soma.
Molueni.
Sawadi khab.
Hello.
Всем привет.
Kalispera sas.
Ni hao.
Hello, world. Hola, buenas tardes. Un gran mensaje, un gran saludo para todas las naciones del mundo.
What's up with it?
Oi.
Добрый день.
Мабитири.
Bonjour.
Hello.
Hola.
Namaste.
Salam alaikum.
Kalimera sas. Kalimera na perasete.
Hello to the world. Hello world.
Hello.
Hi.
Aslema.
G'day Martato.
Jamwali.
Maskar.
Konnichiwa. Hajimemashite.
Salam atsudarma.
Kore.
Bonjour tout le monde.
Jumrebsu.
met her.
Hola, buenos días.
Assalamu alaikum.
Armasın elimdeki kalkım.
Hello, everyone. I greet you with the master word, peace.
Zuwa baku ora boni kelimu aranja. Ngealo baku mulo nga boite. Kena un sarza hotelisha ya kena boshala.
YouTube, so go check it out. I love watching that video. It makes me smile. It makes me curious. And it really reminds me that I live in a beautiful, diverse planet. Those people, such diversity there. And for all of us, let's keep doing what I said my first point was, which is to become more aware and develop an accurate perception of the world around you. That will help you as you are trying to survive and thrive in our multicultural world. So the more that you know, I think the better for your future. The more you know about how other cultures, their traditions, their values, languages, the ways of thinking, the better. You can learn a lot from books, from movies, from the internet. But I do really think that video and my exercise can only take you so far. Actually meet, live, study with people from different backgrounds. Okay, now let's transition to talking more about the benefits and the challenges of multiculturalism, of diversity. Because it's not just a beautiful story, it's not just a story of conflict, but it's both. So I'll give you my ideas, and then I welcome you to add your own ideas as well. So some challenges about multiculturalism. Let's start there. One of the biggest challenges definitely has to be the communication barriers. It's incredible that all of you are sitting in this room listening to me speak English. How many people have English as their native language? Just me? Okay, great. So perhaps something that I've said actually has not been communicated accurately. We have been able to communicate through this language, but there's without a doubt communications barriers when you're speaking with people in second, third, fourth languages. I can't count the number of times when I've tried to explain something to a student at LCC and received back this kind of blank stare, like, what did you mean by that? Or idioms, for instance. I really love the English language. I love speaking in creative, flexible ways. But idioms do not translate. Have you noticed that? Humor does not always translate. Yes, that's definitely true. Humor doesn't always translate. And neither do things like body language. And body language is something which is interesting. A couple of years ago, I was just sitting with a friend, and my hands sometimes fidget a little bit when I'm just not focusing on them. And I do things like this. And this means nothing to me, but I did this. I was just thinking. And my friend was like, what? You want to drink? Who's drunk? What? I didn't mean to communicate anything, but you do communicate at all times through your body language, whether you intend to do so or not. And the risk of miscommunication is much higher when people haven't come and been trained in the same methods of communication. And I'd like to show you another video right now, which is going to show two groups of people who are, I imagine that they are going to start some sort of business agreement with each other. And they're trying to get to know each other through this dinner, and some miscommunication happens. So as you're watching, please try to figure out what is the Englishman trying to communicate, and what are the Chinese people in the video trying to communicate? Or what is the English person's assumptions and the Chinese people's assumptions? Okay? And no, let's just leave it there. So let's watch.
Oh.
The English believe it's a slur on your host's food if you don't clear your plate. Whereas the Chinese feel you're questioning their generosity if you do. At HSBC, we never underestimate the importance of local knowledge, which is why we have local banks staffed by local people in over 80 countries across the globe. HSBC, the world's local bank.
So what was the Englishman trying to communicate?
Respect.
Show respect. And what were the Chinese people trying to show?
Their generosity.
Their generosity. Do you think that each of those people heard the message of the other party? They actually communicated the opposite of what they wanted to communicate in a very funny way, but can you imagine being that British guy? I don't think you'd actually want to be in that situation with him. Not only was it uncomfortable for him, but it also potentially cost companies millions of dollars, if you think about it. Relationship is important in global business. Establishing the correct types of relationships which show respect and trust with each other. I think of some more examples. It's very funny sometimes to look at advertisements in different cultures, in different societies, when an international company is bringing their product for the first time into a new society, there's a huge risk of miscommunication. I think of an ad I saw. The company was advertising aftershave that men put on their face, and I don't know exactly what men do with aftershave, but after the shave. And they used an advertisement of a man, and it was a pretty pastoral scene. He was like sitting, I don't know, on his deck, there's a field, and he has this dog right next to him, and the dog's head is right on his knee, and he looks just very happy and nice. Can you picture that image with me? What are your emotions when you think about that image?
Peaceful,
enjoy, nice. Well, that product completely failed to sell in the Middle East. Why?
Because they read from left to right.
It just had, just think about the image. Something about the image made it not sell well.
Green? Maybe green color?
Not the green color.
The dog.
Why the dog?
Do not shave.
Nice. No, it just has to do with the perception in certain countries in the Middle East towards dogs as being unclean animals. So here you are trying to sell something that's for hygiene and for making you feel clean and nice, and you're using a very dirty symbol in the advertisement. So their emotional reactions and their interpretation of the message was entirely different than what was intended to communicate. Yeah?
Yeah, there also was an ad by Gilbert, I think, a company that made baby food. Mm-hmm. So they wanted to bring their product to Africa. So they put this nice ad, and on a box with their food, there was a baby, like, yeah, it's for babies. But there are a lot of people in Africa who cannot read. So usually in Africa, they put in countries of Africa, in some countries, they on a box, they put the picture of food.
Yeah.
What is yeah. made or what it looks like after you make it. So, and when they put the baby on the box,
yeah.
It didn't sell well.
I'm sure it didn't sell well. Goodness. Anyone have any other examples that they want to share?
But I do believe that nowadays companies are smart. I mean that they can organize local offices to understand mm-hmm. what's going on inside and mm-hmm. Think in an appropriate way. And nowadays I have lots of examples that in one country, for example, they like big sizes, king sizes, huge portions and so on. In other countries, they are like more with smaller and nowadays local people, local marketing, they help to multinational companies to do everything proper inside.
Yes, it is getting better, and that makes me, as someone who is in the intercultural field, very happy, because intercultural issues should apply to every sphere of life. Business and such is not some separate world that's not impacted by this. Culture affects, I think, every area. But some of these examples that were just given were not that old. Sometimes you need to be reminded. I've seen examples still in my own life of terrible translations and things like that. So let's keep a focus on and continue to get better. So communication barriers are definitely one of the first challenges of multiculturalism. And multiculturalism usually is focused on societies where people from different ethnic or cultural groups live together. So for instance, in Kyiv, not just companies having offices around the world, that would be more connected with globalization. So when people are neighbors, it becomes even more crucial that we develop accurate and helpful communication methods. Because I think it should be obvious why. Okay, let's move on. Some more challenges. Whenever in a society you have people from these different backgrounds, one of the major challenges is going to be cultural value differences. Oftentimes when people try to define what is culture, they draw a picture of an iceberg. Are you familiar with that image of culture? Well, for those of you who are not, whenever you look at an iceberg, what you see is above the water is 10% of what the iceberg is. There's 90% under the water. So above the water, what do we see? We see language, we see clothing, we see food, we see
religion.
Dances. Sorry?
Religion.
We see the actions of religion, maybe not why they're doing certain things. But what we see above the water is only 10%. And when I interact with students who are constantly saying things like, oh, we're all the same. We're all human. You're no different from me just because you came from another country. I say, yes, that's true. We have more in common than we have different. But it's undeniable that there are differences. And the differences that matter are the ones that are under the water. Not just if you wear Vishivanka on holidays or not. What's under the water is what really can cause problems for a society if you're not aware of those problems, or of those differences, let's just say. Here's a quote from Charles Taylor, who studies multiculturalism, has written some very good work. He's speaking here about democracies. Democracies that have people coming from different places. He says that democratic societies need a very powerful sense of common bonding and purpose around certain basic goals and principles. So if you bring together people that have really fundamental different values, it is very hard to create a functioning democracy. So you can have differences in a society, but you also need to have some things that you hold in common with each other, even if you come from different religions. You see what I'm saying? Let's take a look here at some cultural value differences. There's another cultural anthropologist named Geert Hofsted, who's done some great work, and he looks at cultural value differences. You can go to his website. I also recommend it. That's where I got this for free. He compares different cultures based on their values, and he has these different cultural values: power distance, individualism and collectivism, masculinity, femininity, uncertainty, and a variety.
From what website is this information?
It's from, yeah, I should have written down his name. Do we have a whiteboard? So that's the name of the researcher, is Geert Hofsted, And so I think his website is just geerthofsted.com. And then if you go to the section of country comparisons, that's where I got this information. He has a number of books as well, which are helpful. So I brought this up just to make a point. I don't see a strong need to walk through all of these cultural value differences, but I compared here the United States, Lithuania, and Ukraine. And you see in some areas, there's a big difference in value orientation. And actually, I think all of them have a variety of differences here. Does anyone have any questions about this image? So go to the website if you're interested in in comparing different cultures and their values, and it'll explain with examples in which ways. Or rather than just going to his website and looking at his anthropological research, you can think about proverbs. Proverbs, I think, are even better way, simpler way to understand cultural value differences. Let's look at these two values. One comes from the United States and one comes from Confucius. In the United States, there's a proverb which says, "Mighty oaks from little acorns do grow." Confucius says, "Let the emperor be an emperor, the minister a minister, and the son a son." Do you grasp the meaning of these different proverbs? And they're saying different things about how a society should be structured. This one here in the United States has this idea that no matter where you're born, into a rich or a poor family, you can grow into a tall oak and you can be the one that's the most powerful in the society. We're all born equal and you can go wherever you want. Whereas this proverb from Confucius is saying, no, hierarchy is good. That is how you should structure a society. Emperors should be emperors, ministers, ministers, fathers, fathers, sons, sons. And it should feel good to you to live in the place that you were given. Can you think of any proverbs in Ukraine which are connected to either one of these ideas about power? Is there one about branches? A tree has many branches or something. Okay, I should have written it down from the last time I gave this lecture. Okay, and then the last challenge that I want to think about with multiculturalism has to do with integration issues. It can be hard to bring together people and actually integrate them into a functioning society rather than having groups here, groups here, groups here, living in the same city but not interacting. History, sometimes there's really serious history that you can't just forget about and move past. Fear of otherness. It's easier to stay separate. At LCC, sometimes I notice people from certain countries preferring to be with just each other. And I challenge them, no, go out and make friends with these other their people. But at the same time, I understand why they would want to stay with their own groups. Let's say you've been in a classroom all day, speaking in English, interacting with people from these different countries. Maybe when you're not working, you want to go home and speak your own language and talk to people that have the same mindset as you. It's a normal thing to do. But it's a challenge if a society wants to actually integrate people that you have to not just stay within your comfort zone, you have to go outside of your comfort zone. Just have a look at this. The last challenge that I was thinking about just has to do with fear of otherness, racism. But I love this quote here that there's only one human race. We don't have time to explore that idea further since we've only got 10 minutes left before we take questions. Let's think now about some benefits. So I gave you all those challenges. So we can't communicate and we're afraid of each other and all these things. But there are really so many more benefits that we should think about. What's one benefit of living in a community with diverse people? What's the first one that comes to your mind?
Getting to know
And that's interesting.
We were speaking about language. It is possible to raise your skills in a quick manner because we have here in this room English, and it is a good way to communicate with each mm-hmm. other, and it helps us to grow.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Language.
Ideas. Okay, let it be ideas, because it is possible to imagine that those people who are from other nations, it is like another mentality, and they have their own another way of thinking. For example, due to the conversation of two different people, they can produce a new idea, new business ideas, and they can develop a good startup, something like that.
Absolutely. We should just make a list of your ideas. These are good ones. There's some of them that I have here. But for me, I don't know if it's just me, but my first reaction when asking why would I want to live in a diverse community is because I like food. Truthfully, that was my first reaction, is that it makes for just a tastier life to be in a community with different types of food. That's been a hard thing for me living in Lithuania. I love Lithuanian food, but I miss the foods that I used to have in the United States since there's a higher diversity there. This comes back to your point, just the interest level. If you're a curious person, there's always something new to learn from people about the way they live, their traditions. And that's something that I have really benefited from by working at LCC. Every day you can learn something new just by talking to a person. You don't even have to go onto the internet. But now for some more serious benefits. One would be it helps you to break your stereotypes. It's really easy to have stereotypes about people when they're further away from you. But when they're sitting right in front of you and you're looking into their eyes, you realize they're not just summed up in this silly stereotype. It forces you to break stereotypes, hopefully, if you're courageous enough to move beyond hello. I have some quotes here. These are from students, so some of them maybe are a little funny. One LCC student said that living there with these people, she learned that not all Americans are fat, good. Not all Lithuanians are sad and slow. And Moldovans aren't stupid. And thank goodness. I mean, if those are the words that are summing up a person just based on where they're from, that's pretty sad. She couldn't continue to think about people in just like one dimension rather than three dimensions. Another student was said that, I realized that so many stereotypes I had are just ridiculous, and I wondered where I got these ideas. Sure, cultures are different, but no person is the embodiment of their country's stereotype. That's happened to me many times. For instance, when I met Syrians for the first time this last year, I was just ashamed of myself. I hadn't been actively having a negative stereotype about Syrians. But I found that I did, and I wondered, where did I get this from? Why did I allow myself to believe these things? And the last one is that I used to think people could not be friends because of certain politics in their countries, and that was broken as well. This comes back a little bit to your point. Seeing from a different perspective? Absolutely. A culture is like an iceberg, but it's also like a pair of glasses. You can also think about culture is your pair of glasses through which you see the world. Your brain gets so much information every single moment through sights and smells and everything, and it needs to be able to funnel it to make sense of all that data. And cultures helps you not go crazy. It's your glasses that filter the information and help you to interpret it quickly and in a way that makes sense and helps you to succeed, to get around. But then when you interact with people from different cultures, they're wearing different glasses. And so you put on their glasses for a while and you see from a new perspective. These pictures here summarize that kind of idea. There's a quote here, which is also a proverb. 2/3 of what we see is behind our eyes. Does that make sense to you, based on what I just said? That our glasses, not just our cultural glasses, other parts of who we are, impact how we interpret the world. And sometimes it's just behind our eyes. It's not the actual truth of a matter. Like these images here along the side. So when you're with these other people, you can step around, see things from a different perspective, and realize that maybe your perspective wasn't always the most correct. Here's a funny example of that. Not a very deep one, but a funny one that made me reconsider things. An LCC student said, I asked a new Chinese student if she knew some friends of mine. And she said that it was very difficult for her to remember the names of the students at LCC. She said, sorry, but all of us white people look exactly the same to her. This was funny to hear the student say this, because the stereotype that our students had was that, no, that Chinese people all look the same. But did we ever think that they might be thinking the same thing about us? It caused that student and me, when I heard this, to take a step back and think, oh, yeah, maybe they're thinking the same things about me. Let's do a quick test. Can you show the third video? So this idea of awareness and seeing from a different perspective. Let me now test your
awareness.
This
is an awareness test. How many passes does the team in white make?
Go!
The answer is 13.
You get that? Good.
But did you see the moonwalking bear?
Go!
It's easy to miss something you're not looking for. This advertisement is don't hit cyclists, but it's the same thing applies for different cultures. It's easy to miss something that you're not looking for. That affects how we interact with them, but then also they can show things from a new perspective than us. Okay, let's go to my last point, which is connected with strength and innovation in communities. Stephen Covey says that strength lies in differences and not in similarities. So if we think again back to business community, there have been studies done about business and innovation and the type of workforce that's needed to really innovate. One survey, which I can look up which one it was, I should have cited it here, said that 85% of top bosses said that a diverse workforce is crucial to drive innovation and economic growth. And one of the reasons for that is connected with creativity and what's called groupthink. Teams that are homogenous or have the same cultures, the same genders, the same economic background, the same everything, are unlikely to produce ideas which are different from each other because they have the same types of experiences. And they run the risk of falling into what's called groupthink. They're in this box in the group, and they can only go this one particular way, and they think as a group. But when you have in the room people that are different culturally, economically, genders, all these different things, you're more likely to innovate. And that is extremely valuable to companies. It's harder. It can cause more conflict. It's going to cause a lot more need for you to focus on your communication skills and on how to show respect and on how to listen. And it's a lot harder, but in the long run, it produces more innovative, more creative ideas. And to prove that, here's an old letter, not old, it's like a month ago, but the news since then has changed a little bit in the US. So have you heard of the travel ban that President Trump?
Certainly.
Okay, good. So there was a travel ban announced on 7, and now it's just 6, predominantly Muslim countries limiting their immigration to the United States. And some of the people that were protesting this the most were top business people. So if you see this image, it has here, here's the Apple. These are tech companies, by the way. So you have Apple, I forget which one he's in, Facebook, Amazon, some of the biggest technology companies were considering a letter, but not just a letter, but suing the American government because of this ban. Because of their commitment to their employees and their true belief that having diverse employees from even these countries will help them to have an edge in the competition economically. It's better for them, not just like based on values, but based on money, to have diverse workforce. And so they were willing to go against the government to fight against that. So I think that we're out of time for me to be sharing any more ideas for you. But let's close there with my main points, that there are a lot of benefits, there are a lot of challenges to multiculturalism. We need to challenge ourselves to have fact-based perception of the world around us, to break stereotypes. We need to be courageous to step into somebody else's shoes, see life from their angle, allow them to criticize us, while also giving our own ideas. And I really believe that multiculturalism can succeed if we are willing to think critically and develop the necessary skills involved with communication and other things like that. Now I'd like to open it up for your ideas, for any questions that you have, things for the better group that you want to talk about. Thank you very much. Yes, what questions? Here, he's bringing a microphone for you.
Oh. Okay. So I wanted to ask you, so you have students from different countries.
Yes.
Well, maybe talking from my experience, I was part of international project, and so Ukrainians and Russians were involved. Mm-hmm. And it was pretty awkward because I don't know for what reason other students from different countries had to maybe a little bit pick sides, right, because of mm-hmm. the grown. So, and if you have that with your students, what the solution to this problem? Because really, Russians were... they were okay, so we talked to them, but we didn't get along very much, so they were a little bit by themselves, and we were with other Europeans and Americans, so, and that was not very good for Russians, for example, so we understood that the whole project for Russians were a little bit spoiled, because everyone took our side, so mm-hmm. if you have there in Lithuania the same problem, how do you deal with it?
Sure, we definitely have that, because we have about 70 Ukrainians, I guess, at our institution, and maybe 30 Russians. Our school is not very big, by the way, just 500, 600 students. So we definitely do, and that comes back to some of the problems that I didn't talk long about it, but history and current events can really get in the way of groups, not just societies, living and getting along. And how to get over it. Yeah. Well, one is that the people involved need to be willing to listen to each other, even when it's uncomfortable. So often we listen, but not to listen, but to wait to speak, if that makes sense. I'm hearing you. I'm just quiet while listening, but only until you be quiet so I can share my idea. But that's not listening. I don't know what exactly that is. So listening requires being active, taking in the other person's perspective, trying to imagine life from their point of view, asking clarifying questions, being willing to reserve judgment of those people, even when it's hard, even when it includes something very personal to you. It doesn't mean you have to change your views on it, definitely not. But people feel more respected and more a part of a community when you listen, especially when it's hard. So that's one thing I challenge my students to do, is to really listen. Before that stage, you have to challenge people to actually get into the same room with each other, because sometimes we're just afraid. We're afraid of the awkwardness, we're afraid of the conflict, and we think, oh, it's better to avoid conflict and awkwardness. But that doesn't build a community that builds actually separation. So getting people in the same room for meals, for just average things, but then also making room for time for intentional discussion about the hard things with a facilitator who helps keep people under control, or you set guidelines for interaction. Like, we're going to listen to each other, and we're going to respect, and you don't have to change your mind, but you do have to listen. That would be one thing. And we've had, I think, some pretty good success at LCC with that. Reconciliation, too, is hard. Yeah. That was an awesome first question. Who's got an awesome second question? Yes.
Why do you think, despite the benefits of multiculturalism, the nationalist movements in different countries prevail and they get popular? Mm-hmm. Like, yeah. Why benefits of multiculturalism are not well known to the public? Why it's not promoted around the world?
Yeah, that's a great question.
Thank you.
That is a great question. I don't know if I would say the benefits aren't known. If you look at the UK, for instance, I was following Brexit, and the places that were most likely to vote Remain in the UK were the urban places that have the most immigrants. So I think those people who are interacting the most in some ways, developing relationships with foreigners, do recognize the benefits. But why does nationalism, why is it gaining strength in our world today? Many reasons. Economics is one. For me, I'm mostly interested in studying the role that identity plays into conflicts. Identity is this like kind of big fuzzy idea. But for me, I think that actual conflicts start with identity understanding. Who am I? What does it mean to be me? What does it mean for me to be an American or you to be a Ukrainian? Does that mean that you have pure blood? Does that mean that you're totally different from somebody from the Middle East or from Poland or from wherever? I would like to work more helping people to develop a more rounded understanding of their own identity and making space in themselves for otherness. Maybe I'm getting a little philosophical up here. Fear definitely is a reason. It's easy to be afraid of things that you don't understand. Stereotypes, the news, when the news only highlights the bad things that a certain community does, then you're not going to have a united society. Like, in the United States, I wish that they would highlight more the benefits, the positive things on the news that people of color do, and less on the crimes that maybe they commit. So the news has a big role to play in keeping us balanced between the good and the bad, you know, that each person is bringing. So who else some ideas that they'd like to answer that? It's a big, big trend. There are many reasons, but if you have some ideas yourself, go ahead. Yeah.
I think it's a problem for countries like Ukraine. Mm-hmm. First time, because we have a very few expats in our companies. We don't know how to work with them, how to communicate with them. We're afraid of them, mm-hmm. and we're Ukrainians always afraid, but they don't understand. Mm-hmm. It's our mentality. It's
yeah.
It's our national feature.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So in our country, we need to
big education program, I don't know, mm-hmm. it's with
social media.
With social media, with television, to realize that it's not tragedy, it's not
it is not
a danger. Yeah, they don't come to
steal our workplaces.
Yeah, yeah.
They just come to share the experience, share the ideas, the approaches,
mm-hmm.
and to help us grow.
Yeah. So it sounds like, to summarize what you said, some of your points, that these movements maybe gain strength because of lack of understanding and the fear, which is connected with not understanding. Yes, and lack of exposure too. Yeah, absolutely. This guy over here, Geert Hofstede, the name of his most famous book is Culture and Organizations, and the subtitle is, and it's important for survival. Yeah, truly, it's important to become more aware and also developing communication skills that enable you to actually understand. I'm drifting off here. Yeah, so one of the programs that I run at LCC is actually for Lithuanian high school students to come and to meet foreigners, to learn about human rights, hopefully build tolerance and multicultural awareness. And it really, really helps to get past fear and to start realizing more of the benefits. I know a lot of people who have strong nationalistic views, but who don't know the people that they're afraid of. So you could be willing to have your own ideas, but don't tell me you haven't actually met the people that you're criticizing.
Also, can I? I think also for Ukraine, the problem with nationalism, which like kind of grew up during the war, during the war, it kind of revealed itself. But it originally comes from, I think, from even primary school and middle school, because for example, I come from Western Ukraine, which is really Ukrainian Ukraine, and I mean, and during school, this kind of really nationalistic perception that is accepted as something normal and something really something that is expected from you, and it's only with some experience, with some age, you realize that maybe it's not that you don't need to be that proud of being Ukrainian and that proud of being of a specific origin. And I think that also comes from high school, and I think it should be a bit more tolerant in the high school education and school mm-hmm. education.
Yeah, do you have something to add to that?
Yeah, but still, I think the problem is that we don't understand foreigners because...
Thank you. We sometimes don't understand foreigners because the question is, I need to understand who you are. But sometimes Ukrainians can do that because we really don't know who we are. Because, that nationalism, that...
Back to the identity.
Yes, that broadening up, like being proud of to be Ukrainians, is coming from a place where we were brought... generation before us were brought up as Soviet Union mm-hmm. citizens, or like particular pretty Russian.
Mm-hmm.
So, and when they say you should speak only Ukrainian, you should be proud of only Ukraine or something like that, is because we're trying to get from that identity, from Russian identity, coming to Ukrainian identity,
mm-hmm.
and then embrace ourselves as truly Ukrainian, and then understand other cultures. But I'd like to add that it's getting a little bit different. It's improving the situation because I just interviewed a student at Kyiv Politic Institute, and he told that he has a lot of friends in his group and they helping him a lot. But he still says that he came from Ecuador, so that's not a big problem. But black students at universities in Ukraine have difficulties because we don't see a lot of people of color. Mm-hmm. And that's the problem. And we still like have these pictures about like street of Compton or like some like drug dealers, because we see a lot of that in movies. Mm-hmm. And also because of Hollywood, as you said. So changing Hollywood is changing our perception of those people. And it's really important to interact with those people. So also.
Yeah. That was an interesting idea you had about not really knowing who we are.
Yeah.
I'll tell you, I learned a lot more about what it means to be an American when I moved to Lithuania. Because that was, for me, showed me what was under the water. Sometimes you don't even know what's under the water of your own iceberg. But in contrast, you start to see it more. And your comments, too, reminded me, I think about the Lithuanian part of this conversation. And for them, so long, they defined what does it mean to be Lithuanian as to be not Russian. Not this. But if your whole sense of identity is against something else, where's the positive content, you know? And then when it became an independent country, now you have a new need to find a national identity without making it against this, against that. What are you? We had a question over here.
Yeah. I've got two questions, actually. And the first is that today in Europe, we actually face some immigrants problem, and it's a huge one. It came to that extent when some law issues occur. And how do you think, from the position of multiculturalism, what side should we get of those immigrants or of people who live there, native people of the country? For example, taking photos in some clothes, you know, for documents, or wearing some clothes, national clothes, on the street, when it comes to Muslims and everything. How do you think, how should we solve that problem? And what side should we get?
Yeah.
And the second one.
Okay, so let's address the first question and then come to the second one, as I'm trying to understand exactly what you're asking. I would challenge one of the things that you even said in your question. Should we be for these people or should we be for these people? The more that we think you have to be us versus them, I think the more problems you're going to have. Us versus them mentalities make for war, make for problems. You can have your own home and your own identity. But still be open to people that are from different backgrounds and not view them as other or as enemy or as something like that. So I think that each country has its own laws and they should be respected, but that each country's laws should be in accordance, in alliance with Universal Declaration on Human Rights, because even if you're not a citizen of a country, you still have rights and they need to be respected. You're no less of a human if you came from another place. So I think that we should be for all people. And we should view immigrants not just as people who try to take things, but as those who can contribute positively to a society because of those benefits that I said about multiculturalism. And there's a lot more benefits for them. And if you think about, I think that we need to be really educated on the people who are coming and on our own laws and such. I find it really distressing whenever someone calls a refugee in the same breath that they refer to an immigrant, because they're not in the same category. Refugees are those who have been forced to flee their own country because of violence or persecution, not because they had a choice to do this. And they're protected under the Geneva Convention. And they're not to be viewed in the same light as those who came for better economics or for better education and stuff like that. So I challenge the people that I know, be more specific in the policies that you want to see differently. Can you say more about what you wanted me to address in your question?
Well, if to say more detailized, no, I don't know. There is a difference between how we treat those law issues in Europe and how those countries where immigrants come from treat mm-hmm. them. For mm-hmm. example, if a European comes to some country from Asia or somewhere else, or a Muslim country, usually he or she has to, assimilate somehow mm-hmm. where those their clothes and other stuff. And if they come here, they are not forced to do anything. That is what I meant, that difference. Difficult one, right?
Sure. Well, I don't think that necessarily our views should be defined based on them being equal and opposite to those that the way that they may have treated us. No, we should strive for what is most ethical in a situation. So just because we may not have been treated most correctly in their societies doesn't mean that we shouldn't treat them correctly. And I don't think it's true that there's nothing that's required of them. They're required to follow the law. But I don't think that we should require people to change their identities, so to speak. Like in the United States, it's oftentimes called a melting pot. Have you ever heard that metaphor for the United States? Okay, I really don't like this metaphor, actually. Because what does a melting pot do? You take all of these different things and you put it in and it all melts together. From like these beautiful colors, it becomes just gray. Everything melted together into sameness. I would prefer a society that's more like a salad. You know, you got all these different ingredients, but together it still has a purpose, you know. It's still a salad. It still has its own identity, and we're together, and it's good to have these different ingredients, you know. In the early days, when some people were immigrating to the United States, especially people who really wanted to come and to become Americans, they used to have these ceremonies where you're Ukrainians or you're Germans or you're Irish would be in their national clothing, doing their national dances and food and stuff, and there would be this stage that had like an arch that was kind of enclosed a little bit. And then they would go through, and they would literally take off their Vyshevankas, and they would put on their like U.S. factory uniform, and now you're American and don't speak Ukrainian anymore. I find that to be a bit of like a violent thing to do to a person, because I don't think we should be forced to give up our values or our backgrounds, but to learn how to respectfully live together. That's what takes a challenge. So that Chinese guy and that British guy, they can work together well and still each be who they are. But he needs to learn, how do I show respect to you? And they need to learn, how do I show hospitality to you? It doesn't just happen like that. You know, it takes intentionality. And it should take intentionality from immigrants who are coming. You know, I'm not saying they don't need to try. They definitely do.
And my second question is actually very much about that, what you just said. It is about different cultures, we think that different cultures might disappear in the nearest future or longer future. Mm-hmm. Because of this
globalization?
Yeah, globalization.
Global culture.
And all those processes of integration. And how do you think, will it happen?
There definitely is a global culture. Like I see it in my students. There are some things that they all seem to share. I think there's a pushback against it, though. Like, connected with this nationalism and other things, there's a pushback to say that, no, we don't want to all be exactly the same. So I don't think it will happen entirely. But one other thing that I do want to say, though, is that it's up to us whether it does happen. Because culture is not something that you're born with. You're born as a baby, you don't know what it means to be a Ukrainian or how you should act or what language you should speak. You're taught a culture and you create a culture. So think about your grandparents. Probably their culture is a little bit different from yours, right? Culture evolves, culture changes. So first of all, let's not think about it as wrong that we are evolving our world and the cultures are evolving. That's natural, that's normal. But do I think that we'll all become uniform? No, I don't think so. I see things that are pushing back against that. Sure.
Thank you. So I have a question about maybe the macro level of multiculturalism. And my question is, how do you judge successfully a multicultural society? I mean, what are the standards for saying, yes, this is a positive example of multicultural society? Mm-hmm. I mean, do you have a bottom standards where as long as they don't shoot at each other, yes. Or like
okay, I hope that's
full
not
integration and full yeah. awareness of the other, like, and everything in between.
Multiculturalism is messy. I don't think any society is going to achieve a perfect balance. But some standards. Well, peace. Let's go with that. That should be included. I would want to see a place that involves more integration. Like in the United States, in many cities, you have Chinatown, you have Koreatown, you have all these different towns, right? Which some I used to think, oh, that's really great. Now I know where I can go if I want Ethiopian food. I can go there to the Ethiopians, and then I can go out and go home. But that's not really ultimately integration like that. Cities shouldn't just be pockets like that. So I'd want to see one that wasn't strictly regimented, like only these groups are really living together and these ones are really living together. I would want to witness conversations that are happening and whether people are actually considering other perspectives actively. Sometimes in a room you have like one woman or something and she's supposed to represent like all women somehow in the world. Same thing happens with cultures. I would want to see that the majority in the room considers the perspectives of minorities. And I don't know how exactly that would need to happen. Like Canada is oftentimes raised on a pedestal as the multicultural oasis of the world. And that's how at least the Canadian government defines itself, is that our identity as a country is we are multicultural. We are a mosaic. They say, US with your melting pot, no way. Mosaic, that's what we are. And the newest government with Prime Minister Trudeau. If you look at his cabinet, it's extremely diverse. I don't think I would like mandate these things. But I think the presence of minorities in positions of power at the table shows if a society is more healthily multicultural. So you asked a really great question. I'd like to hear, do you have any ideas?
I'm actually doubtful about the idea of multiculturalism per se. I study intercultural conflict management in Berlin, and in the studies we've done, like these ideas, a lot of things they work on the paper, and then when they are translated into the actual society, they tend not to work as much as expected. then, and I struggle in finding a society that can be said, okay, that's a mm-hmm. successful multicultural society, let's mm-hmm. learn from this
we
society.
We should give ourselves a little more time, though, don't you think? It's in some ways a new idea.
The thing is that, policies for successfully achieving multiculturalism, like as long in my experience at least, they are reduced most of the time to either education programs or mm-hmm. Media strategies.
Mm-hmm.
And like it seems something philosophically well defined, but then when we go to how do we do that?
Yeah.
Then that's the reason why I ask you for standards for mm-hmm. judging. Like, how do we do that?
Yeah, it's hard for me to answer since I'm working in a smaller community. I'm not working on governmental policy, but on how to bring together college students. I hope I don't end up as cynical as you. Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah, sure.
Thank you, Ella, because we're interested in emotion and maybe more open-minded to show us our own stereotypes about, because for my own, I see that I have a lot of stereotypes and maybe lack of knowledge and maybe a lack of self-confidence because this is there is some problem with communication. Maybe we are shy a little bit. So maybe you can tell for us some kind of advice you can give to our Ukrainian audience, you know, to be more self-confident because for me personally, in European society, we always don't feel ourselves like equal.
Okay. Don't feel ourselves like equal. We mm-hmm. always wait for some kind of special treatment. So maybe you can give some kind of advice for us to this balance between self-confidence and understanding of our identity. And the second question, more personal for you, what is your, you know, like everyday motto to live in the world in Lithuania, you know, in another world, in another culture? Yeah.
I have a motto, kind of. I don't know if it connects with living overseas.
Just living your own life, not in Lithuania. Just
sure. I have a little sign in my office which says, kindness matters. That's my motto. I think that our world and... I tend to think that the big issues, the big successes, and the big problems of society start with individuals and small acts, and that's why I have on my wall the phrase kindness matters, because how I treat a student when I show that I respect their dignity, their value as a human, those little things add up to big things. So yeah, kindness matters. People love each other in little ways. And how to become more confident? Well, you're not going to become more confident unless you step outside of your comfort zone. That's definitely true. If you stay always within, then you're never challenged. And when you challenge yourself and you succeed or you fail, you realize it wasn't as scary as you thought it would be. Let's see. Becoming more confident. I had never thought about teaching that. Gosh, that's a hard question for me. Step outside of your comfort zone, be willing to fail, and be willing to succeed. That's a big one. Maybe have supportive friends around you That's a big one too. I work with young people, and their environment around them influences them greatly. And when there's a culture of negativity, a culture of you can't do this, or that was so bad, that's not going to build anybody's confidence. So in the United States, we probably have a problem of praising people too much. 10th place, here's your medal. I mean, that's maybe a bit much. But at least in Lithuania, I've encountered a bit of an idea that we won't mention if you do something right, but if you do something wrong, we will definitely point it out to you. And so perhaps you can develop more confidence if you yourself make an effort to point out in your friends and in your family when they do something really well or that you appreciated in them, and building a culture of supporting each other could be helpful. I'll have to think about it more. Maybe I can say something more afterwards. Was there one more question over here?
Here.
She hasn't asked a question.
Okay, have you ever had some stereotypes about Ukraine and Ukrainians, and how is it now when you are here?
I was predisposed to like Ukrainians because I wanted to come to Europe. Well, as a student, I wanted to study abroad. I was thinking about studying in Ukraine. I ended up in Lithuania because this university has people from Ukraine and Lithuania and Russia and all these different places. So I was predisposed to like you. Let's see. I think a stereotype that Americans have is that, I don't know, that you're very tough and serious and closed, not smiling. And maybe that the fact that you don't smile means that you're not so friendly. But I have been refreshed in my friendships with Ukrainians because they don't pretend with you. Americans, it's very polite to smile and to say you're okay even when you're not okay, and to be friends with everybody. But it doesn't like mean that much always. Don't take that as a stereotype that Americans are shallow. We're not shallow. But I've been refreshed that for Ukrainians, when you're friends with them, it really means something, kind of long-term and deeper. So that I've really liked. Other stereotypes? I think you guys are maybe more emotional than I thought you'd be, actually. Yeah, because of that kind of Slavic energy. It's just different from Lithuanians. Lithuanians are more calmer. Ukrainians on the floor, students are louder. But not all of them. Some of you are quiet. Well, I think we're... How are we doing on time? What does that mean? Keep going? Yeah, sure.
Sorry, I think that will be the last one. I was listening to all the questions and answers, and I thought, do you think that it's okay when those positive changes in developing multiculturalism can be, if they are forced? For example, when there are some quotes, if I picked the right word, for women in parliaments or something like that. Is it okay, and should it be so? Thank you.
Wow. I think sometimes it's necessary, but I wouldn't want that to be the ultimate way of making a change in society. Back to my quote about kindness matters, I think that little things, when you mean them, and having like an internal sense is much better way to make a society more open and tolerant. But in the United States, was it a bad thing whenever the government changed their laws about African Americans integrating into schools? No, it was great that it was kind of forced on people. I think that it moved us along, even though it was challenging at the beginning. And our leaders need to be wise about which ones and what the society is ready for. So, quotas. I don't know. I'm someone who's a little bit more in favor of affirmative action. Do you know what affirmative action is? Affirmative action in the United States refers to giving some preferences to minorities to help increase their presences in like universities and things like that. So it really bothers Americans, many Americans, because it breaks our idea that everybody's equal. But I think they've experienced some things which weren't equal, which put them further behind. So sometimes affirmative actions like that are necessary. I'm not going to give you some like yes, no answer. I think like anything, you should have nuance. That was part of my whole presentation, was balance and nuance. So I want leaders who are willing to be courageous and make some unpopular moves, but I don't think they should force society in every area. And maybe if they do, you get more of a backlash and more of a nationalism kind of uprising. I'm not international relations person, so that would be really hard for me to answer. Okay.
Should we finish up and then people can ask you questions one-to-one, if that's possible?
Yeah. So you can come up afterwards and ask me. And I'd like to finish by saying thank you. You have really engaged with this material, and that makes me very excited. I would also like to remind you that my colleague Lydia is here, and that up at the front we have brochures about our really amazing university, LCC International University. So please come and take them. Please talk to Lydia if you want to know more about our studies and how you can come and be with us.
Thank you.
Thank you.